honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 113, recorded in Denmark, October 2018. And you are indeed welcome.
Friends, exceptionally rare is the arising of the soul next to awakening. The blessed Buddha once said this: Bhikkhu, the exquisitely refined and sophisticated seven links to awakening, do never arise apart from the appearance of a welcome, well-gone one, an arahant, a perfectly self-enlightened Buddha. They never emerge outside the discipline of a thus happy and successful one. Which seven? One, the awareness linked to awakening, sati sampayanga. Two, the investigation linked to awakening, dhammavichaya sampayanga. Three, the energy linked to awakening, virya sampayanga. Four, the joy linked to awakening, piti sampayanga. Five, the tranquility linked to awakening, prasati sampayanga. Six, the concentration linked to awakening, samadhi sampayanga. Seven, the equanimity linked to awakening, pikka sampayanga. These uniquely advanced, delicate and intricate seven factors of enlightenment do never emerge other than after the arrival of a Tathagata, an arahant, a perfectly self-enlightened Sammasambuddha. They never emerge outside the teaching and discipline, a sasana of a fortunate one. The seven links to awakening develop sequentially. The blessed Buddha once explained, whenever while withdrawn in body and withdrawn in mind, one reflects on the Buddha Dhamma, then the awareness linked to awakening arises and develops. Thus acutely aware, one examines that awareness itself. Whenever examining a mental state, then the investigation linked to awakening arises and develops. While thus being curious and enthusiastically investigating, keen energy is now aroused. When energy is aroused in one who is enthusiastic, then the energy linked to awakening arises and develops. When energetic and enthusiastic, one succeeds. Therefore, joy is born from that advance, that progress. Whenever achieving in eager joy, then the joy linked to awakening arises and develops. One thus joyous becomes mentally satisfied and therefore calm, both in body and in mind. Whenever calmed in body and mind, then the tranquility linked to awakening arises and develops. One thus satisfied, calmed, serene, settled, and tranquil in both body and mind becomes exquisitely happy. Whenever calmed and comfortable in the body and tranquil and happy in the mind, then the concentration linked to awakening arises and develops. When mentally concentrated, one reviews all states rationally and reasonably, as if from above. Whenever one well balanced reviews all phenomena rationally and realistically, as if from above, then the equanimity linked to awakening arises and develops. In equanimity, one knows and sees things just so, right as they really are now, and right as they really later become. It is in this very way that the seven links to awakening develop sequentially, one after another, successively, one leading to and producing the next. How do these seven links to awakening induce breakthrough? The Blessed Buddha once said, "And what, bhikkhus, is a method to induced waste penetration? It is these seven links to awakening." What seven? The awareness linked to awakening, the investigation linked to awakening, energy linked to awakening, the joy linked to awakening, the tranquility linked to awakening, the concentration linked to awakening, and the equanimity linked to awakening. Then the Venerable Udai asked the Blessed Buddha, "How are these seven links to awakening developed and cultivated so that they lead up to and induce waste penetration?" Udai, when a bhikkhu develops these seven links to awakening, supported by seclusion, viveka, supported by dissolution, and associated with ceasing, then they culminate in a mental release, which is waste, exalted, and infinite, without any trace of ill will or opposition. When such exalted mind, matured and refined by these seven links to awakening, he smashes, penetrates, and eliminates the massive greed that he has never before penetrated, smashed, and eliminated. He penetrates, demolishes, and eradicates a heap of hate that he has never before penetrated, demolished, or eradicated. And he penetrates, disintegrates, and disperses the accumulation of confusion that he has never before penetrated, disintegrated, and dispersed. It is Udai, when these seven links to awakening are developed and cultivated in exactly this very way, that they lead to this incisive breakthrough of penetration. Thank you. And these texts are from the group sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Section 46 on the links. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 113, recorded on the 12th October down at Isefjord in the middle of Denmark, on a silent, cool day. There are three questions. But first, the normal intro. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Before we go to the questions, I'd just like to remind once again, there is a meditation course from the 10th December to the 1st January 2019, this coming December. You can participate as many days as you like. This is on an old hotel, wooden hotel, in North Carolina, USA. And we will go through all the 40 meditation subjects put forth by the Buddha and train in detail in 6 of them. It's a silent retreat and you are indeed welcome. The purpose of the retreat is calm, samatha and insight, vipassana. Question 348. What is the exact meaning and translation of the word Samma Sankappa? Samma, right, Sankappa, I think is best translated motivation. Some says intention, but intention is usually reserved for the word Chetana in Pali. So this cannot be used. Right motivation, I think, is a proper word. Also, when you consider what is the definition of this Samma Sankappa, right motivation, which is, as we know, the second factor in the Noble Eightfold Way, which is right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration, Samma Samadhi. First off the bat regarding right motivation is the motivation for withdrawal. Withdrawal out of dependencies, out of involvement, out of entanglement. In what is entanglement? This is any kind of engagement which is you have clung to and is kind of like bound to. Can be loans in houses. It can be love affairs. It can be parenthood. It can be childhood also, if you should take care of your parents. Anything that restricts or limits your personal freedom. That is involvement. Can also be something very hot-headed passion for this or that. This is involvement, engagement, which leads to clinging. The opposite is disentanglement, dispassion, disillusion, letting go. And this is exactly what this is about. Withdrawal is pulling out of it. Whatever you have been entangled in without knowing it, like a man who stands with a rope in his mouth and then turns around, then he binds himself up without knowing it, without noticing it. So this is entanglement. And disentanglement comes by withdrawal, by cutting off all the ropes. Not that are outside in the world, though they seem to be most commonly interpreted as the most important, but it's those inside, those bindings, those bondages, those clingings, those tenacious attachment of a mental nature that one cannot give up or release. As long as you cannot release the mind, then of course one is not free. This goes without saying. So one is the motivation for withdrawal, is being motivated by the general absence of greed, absence of craving, absence of desire, being motivated by a generous giving, relinquishing all possessiveness, being motivated by detachment of the 5 senses of urge for alluring and tempting sights, sounds, smells, tastes and touches. Is being motivated by cutting attachment to the 5 clusters of clinging. This cutting attachment to all forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions and consciousness. Such radical renunciation. This is right motivation. First factor. Second factor is a motivation for non-ill will. That is basically the same as being motivated by goodwill. Is being motivated by universal friendliness, infinite goodwill, kind care, non-anger, non-hate, non-aversion, and sympathy, wishing and working for the sentient being's happiness, content, comfort, benefit, and welfare. Such gentle kindness is right motivation. The opposite of ill will. This is right motivation. Goodwill. Helpfulness, gentleness, friendliness, in particular. 3. being motivated by total non-violence. This is harmlessness that is pulled forth here, ahimsa in Pali. Being motivated by absolute non-violence, absence of cruelty and compassionate pity, thereby offering all sentient beings guaranteed safety and protection from any evil, painful, bad and wrong treatment. Such offer of full protective fearlessness to all beings is right motivation. So this basically is the biggest offer you can give to the whole world of living beings. That is this absence of cruelty, which equals harmlessness and complete non-violence. This is to say to all beings, give them to all beings, I'll never harm you. You can trust that. You have safety from me harming you. This is the greatest gift one can give. And this, of course, other beings will react to and take into consideration. Question B under this is, what is always preceding the action? Yes, that actually is intention, chetana, and usually also internal speech. So first you intend it, usually semi-conscious or subconscious, but still actively making a choice between all these actions and then this particular action. And then it's materialized or solidified, you can say, by you say to yourself, I like to do this and that, doing planning. And then it comes out in action, right action or wrong action, or neutral action, kiriya action. What are the factors determining the actions of individual? And they are multifold. Basically, on the deep down level, from a Buddhist perspective, then it's the three roots, defilements, namely greed, hate and ignorance, and the opposite defilements, non-greed, which is generosity, non-ill will, which is harmlessness and goodwill, and non-ignorance, which is understanding the Four Noble Truths. This is on the possibly deepest level we can come down. Then they are mixed up to say all good qualities counteracted by all good qualities or bad qualities. That is the defilement and then the mental qualities. And these two in summation will determine the behavior of given individuals. So if it's a good qualities that at that particular moment are having the most forceful power, then it will be a good action with wholesome results, with advantageous results. That is result in pleasure and happiness for the actor. And opposite, if it's the mental defilements that has the upper hand at that particular moment, then of course the bad actions will result, and then the results will be painful and unsuccessful. Question 349. How can it be that the Dhamma comes exactly when needed? And yes, this is true. Often the Dhamma comes exactly when needed and kind of like slaps you in the face or woos you on the head. Exactly when needed. And I have to say up front, I don't know why that is. But it has been noticed by many, including myself, that it's uncanny how good the timing of the Dhamma is. It's called synchrony. I think one can have some get some touch on it or handle on it by considering non-locality or entanglement in quantum mechanics. This basically says that states can be entangled in a way that if one varies, then the other varies also. So they act if they were one, and they can be as far as one end of the universe and other end of the universe, and then they will co-vary like this. And this means that they're still connected. And this basically goes for all states, all mental states and all material states. They are basically not separable, fully separable. So this means that all states, all molecules, all bits of information, all thoughts in the entire universe, in the entire cosmos is connected by some statistical correlations. This means basically that if you interpret mass and also the energy that is contained in consciousness as its equivalent, namely information. So mass is equivalent of energy, and energy is also an equivalent of information. Then you can have a space of information, or that there is information in all of space. Again, since space and time is really one thing called space-time according to Einstein, then it seems that if there's correlation in space, there must also be correlations in time. And if you then have such a landscape I show here with global and local minima, then there can be a landscape where information is much needed in a so-called global minima or a local minima here and there, and then there can be a surplus of information other parts in space and time. And then I think the information will seek, it's also called entropy, it will seek where it is needed most. And then it will, so to speak, fall down, like the illustrations here, it will fall down into either local minima or global minima of where it is needed. And this means that if one is in a given philosophical or practical conundrum, then one needs some information very much. And if one has this, one's probabilities of karma are of such a nature that one has access to this information, then one will either turn attention to it, or it will come into one's attention, so to speak, by itself. Much like something is fallen because it has larger mass, and it's in a field of gravity. You can say the field in this case will be need of information. The field of this case will then be basically ignorance, not knowing something. So ignorance, if that can be compared to a field strength, just like a field strength of gravity, highest here at the Earth, and then being diluted as we go away from Earth with the square of the distance, then I think also this field of ignorance can be graduated. Just like you can have the opposite would be in information density. For example, this they measure regularly on hard disk, how much information you can have on a given square or cubic millimeter of space inside. So the information density should be higher and higher and higher for the hard disk makers. Since you can have an information density, you can then can also have a field of information, and then I think also you can have the opposite, a vacuum of information, so to speak, or a need for information, or a field of ignorance. And then the information will seek down local and global minima in this landscape of absence of information. This is my best shot at it. So, to speak, that the state of information falls into the pits where the ignorance is maximal. This makes the state of information fall into the pits where the ignorance is maximal, where the pits are most deep and dark. Question 350. If a non-Buddhist asks you how to meditate or why do we meditate, how would you answer? Yes, it is to get calm and insight. Why so? Because the insight improves behavior by increasing the morality or the purity of the ethics. And then this improves the future. So first meditation is first to get calm, then when the mirror doesn't vibrate anymore and you can look through the mirror, then you get insight. After insight comes improvement of behavior. So it goes from being mixed, disadvantageous and neutral to being mixed, neutral and advantageous. And until it only becomes advantageous. Kusala. Advantageous means that is the driving motivation behind the action is a complete absence of greed, absence of hate, and absence of ignorance. If these three roots are not involved in any way, either directly or indirectly, in the action, then it's advantageous. This means that the results will be pleasant and happy and successful. So meditation not only causes well-being here and now, it does, undeniably, but it also ensures an improved future through this insight that comes induced by this calm that is the purpose of meditation. So this means that it improves future and it guarantees from downfall. And that's why we meditate. And that's why the Buddha's common admonition, he said it many times, here are roots of trees, here are empty huts, sit down and meditate, don't be lazy, don't become one who is later remorseful or regretful. This is my instruction to you. Our roots of trees, they're empty huts, sit down and meditate. Otherwise you will regret it later. Another place in Samyutta Nikaya, get up, sit up, what's your need for sleep? And how sleep is there for the one who is tortured, who is afflicted, pierced by the arrow, oppressed, get up, sit up. So again, very acutely pushing this urge for the need of meditation. That one should really push for it oneself. Train firmly for the sake of peace. Don't let the king of death, seeing you heedless, deceive you and bring you under his sway. Samyutta Nikaya. Nay, Sutta Nipatta 2.10. So, the Buddha many times admonished his monks in this way. Here are roots of trees, here are empty huts. Sit down and meditate, don't be lazy. Don't become one who is later regretful. This is my instruction to you. It cannot be said clearer, I think. So it's something that he said in particular, I think, to intellectual disciples that tends to go too far into the books and into the text and become intellectual disciples that get insight but no calm. And meditation is necessary. It is, because it goes hand in hand with insight, as we will see. It goes hand in hand with insight. What can be more fitting than to expose what the Buddha said about breathing meditation, anapanasati, than this opportunity to promote it? The Buddha on breathing meditation from the Majjhima Nikaya, number 118, the Anapanasati Sutta, the Breathing In and Breathing Out Sutta, which has aspects of both serene calm and incisive insight, vipassana. Because there's one unique thing, which when trained and cultivated, is of great fruit and great advantage. What is that one unique thing? It is awareness by breathing. Anapanasati. And how, Bhikkhus, is this awareness by breathing trained, developed, cultivated, and refined so that it is of great fruit, of immense long-term advantage? How is constant awareness established only by breathing? Sitting cross-legged with straight back, elevated chin, in a silent place, the yogi remains focusing all attention on the touch point of air inside his nostrils. Fully aware, one inhales, and fully aware, one exhales. When inhaling a long breath, one notices just that. When exhaling a long breath, one notices just that long breath. When inhaling a short breath, one notices just that short breath. When exhaling a short breath, one notices just that. Experiencing the whole body, one inhales. While experiencing the whole body, one exhales. Calming all bodily activity, one inhales. Calming all bodily activity, one exhales. One trains us, experiencing joyous rapture, I will inhale. Experiencing joyous rapture, I will exhale. Experiencing a happy pleasure, I'll inhale. Experiencing a happy pleasure, I will exhale. Experiencing all mental activity, I will inhale. While experiencing all mental activity, I will exhale. This is now calming all the mental activities. Calming all mental activity, I will inhale. Calming all mental activity, I will exhale. One trains us, experiencing and evaluating the present mood, I will inhale. While experiencing and evaluating the present mood, I will exhale. Satisfying, gladdening and elevating the mind, I will inhale. Satisfying, gladdening and elevating the mind, I will exhale. Focusing, condensing and concentrating the mind, I will inhale. Focusing, concentrating and condensing the mind, I will exhale. Releasing the mind from any hindrance, I will inhale. While releasing the mind from any hindrance, I will exhale. One trains us, considering the impermanence inherent in all change, I will inhale. Considering the impermanence inherent in all change, I will exhale. Considering the detachment induced by disillusion, I will inhale. Considering the detachment inherent in illusion, disillusion, causing detachment, I will exhale. Considering still silence due to ceasing, I'll inhale. Considering still silence due to cessation, ceasing, I'll exhale. Considering the open freedom of relinquishment, I'll inhale. Considering the open relinquishment and freedom thereof, I will exhale. Breathing meditation done in this way can be of immense advantage. Why so? Because it can induce both the first, second, third and fourth jhana. It starts with calming the body, first tetrad, secondly calming the mind, then considering the mental qualities and phenomena in general, and thereby relinquishing them in the end, is the pure insight of the fourth tetrad. As the Buddha say, this is how continuous awareness is established by breathing. It is because when awareness by breathing is trained, developed and refined in exactly this way, that is of great fruit and advantage. It's a unique practice because all the Buddhas, they attain enlightenment by this breathing meditation technique. And this was from the middle-length sayings that you see here of the Buddha, the Majjhima Nikaya number 118, the Anapanasati Suttas. And so many were the words for today. Thank you indeed to all Dayakas supporters and friends, especially the regular donors. And then comes the exit as usual. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Remember to click subscribe and have a nice day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.